is compared to Toru. Will that be a factor? That's Christine Hallower. And this fight is brought to you by Naga World, the best integrated business, leisure and entertainment hub in Cambodia. Right now we're in Myanmar and this is a world title fight. Bibiano goes right after his opponent here, knee to the body. It's quick action. Bibiano already has Toru's back. He wriggles out of it.
Yeah, Bibiano's wasting no time here. And Tony said that he was he didn't want to be labeled as a grappler here, but he needs to utilize that length that he has, his height and all that kind of stuff.
He may have no choice the way Bibiano started this. That was a smashing overhand right that dropped Toru. And immediately, Bibiano jumped right on top of him.
Classic Bibiano. Got his guy against the cage, but Toru's working a good butterfly guard there. Had if the cage hadn't been in the way, he would have had a good sweep there, possibly.
You concentrate on Bibiano's jiu-jitsu skills, three-time world champion, but that was a strong right hand. It was sharp, it was quick, it was accurate. He was the dream bantamweight champion. He was the dream featherweight champion, and now he's the one bantamweight champion. The accolades just keep coming for this man. And his opponent, Tony Toru, must overcome a great deal to step into his shoes. Oh, looking for the leg lock.
Toru's doing a good job. He did a good job with the butterfly guard earlier, stayed calm, reestablished his guard when he was in half guard. And he swiveled underneath Bibiano's legs there and immediately looked into some sort of, he's got an Achilles lock or working for one. Now he's starting to dive for the heel, but this is not a position that Bibiano is unfamiliar with, and he looks very calm and relaxed here.
At the moment, he's just got to make sure that his body doesn't get twisted against the natural way that leg would move. That's the main focus.
So you can see Tony trying to dig his elbow underneath that heel there. And what he's going to try to do is get his elbow right underneath the heel and then use that to lift and kind of rotate the heel while the toes are stuck in the armpit.
The heel is exposed, the knee as well, potentially, the left knee there. No great danger, I think. As you say, Bibiano's familiar with this.
Bibiano's out now.
Nice right hand as they stepped up as well. You've got to defend yourself at all times. That includes when you're getting up to your feet. Bibiano was the sharpest.
I'd like to see Tony circles back away from that cage so he has the space to back up when Bibiano shuts that distance down, uses height a little bit.
Well, he looks so much taller, Rich, doesn't he, as well? He must have the big advantage in Rich. Flying knee, which landed on the forehead.
But it's those kind of techniques that Tony does that's going to put him right in the danger zone.
Oh, overhand right brushed Toru's face.
Nice head inside leg dump there to half guard. And the thing I like about Bibby, the one thing I like about what he does here is as soon as he earns a technique, he's in half guard and he doesn't relax there. He immediately begins pressuring, looking either for the pass or to do damage right away. He's just not happy establishing a superior position in half guard. And what does he do? He peppers his guy with the punches and then moves immediately to the cross mount.
Yeah, he is the busiest of fighters. That's certainly true.
It's textbook MMA.
Now, notice how Toru is pushing the head away so that he can get that knee to contact the head there. Earlier on, Bibby was just getting his head out of range, but now he's seeing his head forced towards the knee. And that will be pretty brutal. Knowledgeable crowd here, by the way, in Yangon. They know exactly what's going on. Throughout the night, they've applauded the most subtle moves.
Well, you can see him get really excited when those knees land to the head. That's something that they like to watch from the letway sport.
Yep.
I'll tell you, for having a guy like Bibiano on top of you, Tony is very, very relaxed and poised in a position like this.
10 wins in a row for Tony Toru speaks volumes about his ability. But has he come up against a man of this stature before? I don't think so.
Yeah, you got to realize Tony's a fighter with a wealth of experience. He had 15 amateur fights. He was the Shooto Scandinavian champion, 10 professional fights.
40 seconds left in this opening round. Maybe trying to work that left arm. See how he's just bending that away from his natural position.
You see Tony waving there to his corner, like checking in with him, saying, hey, I'm okay, guys, don't worry about it.
Bibiano's foot is just clutching at the fence there, which is not a legal move. Yuji Shimada didn't quite spot that one, otherwise he'd have been straight on it. Tony TAURU doing something similar now with his left foot. Final 10 seconds of the round then. Five 5-minute rounds in this championship contest. Bibby opening his palms saying, oh, not much I can do at this stage. I'll wait out the round until the bell goes and go back to my corner men. The champion is Bibiano Fernandes. The challenger, Tony Dynamite TAURU, who's 30 years old and is on a 10-fight unbeaten streak there in the red shorts.
I would like to see Tony use his height in this round, and I think he needs to if he actually wants to get ahead on the scorecards.
Yeah, it, you figure it would be an essential tactic for him. Landed a good right hand there, just exhibiting exactly the kind of advantage that Rich is alluding to. And again there with the 1-2, it was the right hand that clipped Bibiano. The left hand just sort of getting that measurement and then pinpoint right hand.
Bibby does such a good job of backing his opponent up to this cage. TAURU has nowhere when Bibby closes the distance, and that wasn't a big close that time, but he just seemed to kind of accept that takedown.
That was just such a simple, effective takedown, wasn't it? Almost effortless from the Brazilian.
Yeah, you know, the fans, they see a takedown, but if you know the fight game, you can see Bibiano just systematically backing his opponent up until he gets close to that cage, and then he shoots the takedown.
Step one, step two, step three. That's what Bibiano's lived his entire life. Used to be a cleaner in a jiu-jitsu gym, and he would watch the fighters through a window, and he was invited in by the gym owner one day and then started submitting people one after the other. Yuji just pulls that leg, Tony TAURU's leg, off the cage, because again he was gripping it with his toes. That's not allowed.
Bibby passes the guard here. He's just setting in cross mount,
where Bibiano is most comfortable on the floor in the mutual clutches of his opponent. Tony TAURU now knows what it's like to be in the cage for several minutes with a world champion, but he's put on a pretty good show. Probably behind at this stage, almost certainly I would say, but the gap is not enormous. And he has looked very calm and very cool in a number of difficult situations.
Yeah, Bibby was actually trying to bring his knee through there to possibly establish mount or something like that, and in doing so, TAURU's end up earning half guard, which is a slightly better position for him, but still with a guy like Bibiano on top of you, he just stays busy from the top, whether it's with punches or constantly improving his position.
Five rounds scheduled in this contest. We're approaching the halfway mark in the second round. The fight will be judged in its entirety, not round by round. Three judges at cage side.
Bibby got himself there in a bit of a predicament. He's out now, but that could have led to a nice little arm triangle.
Yeah, yeah.
TAURU was trying to capitalize on it, just could not.
His own arm there pushed against his neck, but he slipped out of it, as Rich said. 2 minutes left in the second round now. Is there much that Bibby can do from this position?
Oh, there's a lot that he can do, but you can see just from the little mistakes that Bibiano makes. For example, we were just talking about TAURU capitalizing and trying to put him in that arm triangle. You could tell that TAURU's a high-level grappler. Like, he's somebody that can capitalize on some things. And Bibiano, being on top of him, even though he's in a superior position, he knows that he just can't get reckless here. And he has to, everything that he does, he has to do with great care. You can see here he's got great shoulder pressure with his right shoulder on TAURU's.
Yep.
On TAURU's chin to keep him from moving. And it's those kind of techniques, like that stuff that you have to do in order to maintain that top position. Otherwise, you're going to end up in a scramble and back to your feet. So even though it doesn't look like there's a lot happening here, there are these slight little technicalities in the game that you have to understand in order to be able to tell what's going on.
Well, for years and years, Bibiano Fernandes has been in this kind of position, finding incremental ways to gain an advantage and finish his opponent.
Yeah, he's clearly, nice knee to the head there too. Clearly winning this fight on ground control at this point in time alone. Not really inflicting a ton of damage, and you can see that TAURU is very calm, but in the judges' scorecards, I would imagine that Bibiano was just second by second with ground control alone, widening the distance with the decision that could be made here.
quite often in this kind of position, a referee would stand the fighters up. But with Bibiano, you know that he could create so much that it would just be so unfair to take him out of this potential advantageous position. But with only 10 seconds left in this second round, I don't think he's going to achieve so very much, although clearly he's in a dominant position, in control, and this would be favorable in terms of the judges' scorecards. So two rounds down, three to go. Bibiano steps off his opponent. What do you make of Tony Taru so far, Rich?
Well, I'll say this, just based on what I've seen so far, and this was the takedown that I was talking about earlier in the cage. That was where Bibiano was systematically backing Taru up to the cage and then used that to just push his opponent against the cage, basically shooting him for the double. And this is Bibiano just maintaining ground control, and that's pretty much been the story of the fight. I'm impressed with Taru as a fighter, though. He's maintained good poise on the ground, especially in bad positions. He's been able to capitalize on small mistakes by Bibiano, and he's forced Bibiano to maybe take a bit more of a conservative approach to this fight. He's just not going to get out there and get reckless with things. When you look at the end of that second round there, and although it doesn't look like there's a lot going on, like I said before, there's tiny little nuances that's going on in that round. There's actually a lot happening.
Round three. Well, in a regular one championship fight, this would be the final rounds, but we have potentially the championship rounds to contend with, rounds four and five. Before we get there, this is round three. Toro, the challenger, in the red trunks. Bibiano Fernandez, the champion, in the black trunks.
Just like to see Taru work out that jab there, and not that pawing jab, but one that would actually make his opponent respect the jab.
Strong of the shoulder, isn't he, Bibiano? Totally different body shape, these two.
Well, that's what 8 centimeters of height will do.
Taru long and lean, but Bibiano so strong, and he's fought at featherweight before. Remember, this is bantamweight. Seems very comfortable, very natural at this weight, though. Overhand right from Bibiano, just missed time, brings the knee up.
Nice punch off the break.
He swung for the fences there with the right hand. We haven't seen much in the way of punching power from Bibi in his one championship career so far, but he can
nice.
Hit, and he hit there, and it's all over.
Yeah. Isn't the timing of that uncanny?
Wow, Yuki Shimada stepped in, and again, perfect timing from the referee, because that was lights out from Bibiano Fernandez.
When you talk about our bantamweight champion not having power in the hands, that's when he's going to step in and knock his opponent out.
He must have heard me and taken offense. Who can blame him?
I'd like to see that one more time, and I think we're going to off the break here. You see a nice uppercut, catches him with the right hand there.
So it was right uppercut, little movement with the left that just brushed the head only, and it was the right hand that finished him off, flush on the jaw.
Yes.
Oh, wow, and he was backed up, and down he went, and he was not getting up after that. And to be fair, Bibi didn't follow up. He knew it was all over. Yuji really didn't have to do much. Bibiano Fernandez has retained his bantamweight championship, and if it was possible to position him any higher, he's just stepped up.
Ladies and gentlemen, referee Yuji Shimada calls a halt to his bout at 1:02 of round number 3 for your winner via knockout, and still the one bantamweight world champion, Bibiano the Flesh Fernandez!
So after winning the bantamweight title by unanimous decision and then defending it by unanimous decision, he has now won by a knockout. His last fight was a submission. He's just showing you, I can finish fights in any number of ways.